Welcome to another episode of Moving Markets Podcast. I am Jeffrey Dunning, the owner and founder of Safe Option Strategies, and this is the daily market update for Safe Option Strategies. It is Wednesday, the 6th of March, 2024. Jerome Powell spoke this morning, right, shortly after the market opened. Going to get you caught up a little bit on what he said, and more importantly, what people heard, because that was the biggest, I think, factor in what the markets did today. No question, people hear what they want to hear, regardless of what might be said. So we're going to get into that, talk a little bit more about the other things coming up this week. We'll talk a little bit more about the ADP jobs report as well. Glad to have you here on a Wednesday. U.S. markets have been open for just about an hour at the time we're recording this, so enjoy the presentation.
This conference will now be recorded.
Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the Moving Market Podcast. Today is March the 6th, 2024. The U.S. stock market has been closed for just about 1 hour at the time we're recording this. Thank you for joining us on this Wednesday afternoon. There are no specific updates today that are for Safe Option Strategies members only. I'm still going to wait until probably tomorrow to make some trade adjustments on some of our collar trades for the open of the market on Friday morning. The only thing I would like to point out is we are officially over 30% now on our trades that we've sent out so far this year. Every trade that we have sent out, whoops, I forgot to change my screen as I did that. Give me 1 second here. Little technical glitch that is 100% my fault. There we go. Anyways, every trade we've sent out since the start of this year has been a profitable trade. We're off to a phenomenal start. We are almost at 31% on the year, so things are looking fantastic there. And like I said, we'll update collar trades tomorrow night, a couple of adjustments for Friday morning's open, and potentially as a little bit of a teaser, maybe one new collar trade that I've been thinking about and watching for a little while and kind of want to throw into the mix. So let's just jump right into what happened today in the stock market. As you can see, the Dow Jones Industrial Average up 75 points, S&P up 26, the NASDAQ up 91, almost 92 points. None of these are huge moves to the upside, but all three of these gave us back a little bit of what we lost yesterday. Yesterday was a big sell-off day. Today definitely got some of it back, and that is a good thing. There's no getting around that, and we don't want to make it seem like less than it was. But these are not huge moves to the upside. We need two or three more days like today to get back everything that we gave up just yesterday. What's important to point out, though, is that today being up a little bit keeps that 20-day moving average just right on that perfect diagonal line that it's been on. It makes it to where the sell-off yesterday and a little tiny bit of sell-off the day before are somewhat meaningless as far as it relates to the 20-day moving average, because that continues to stay on almost that perfect pace that it's on. So let's jump over and talk about why the markets moved the way they did today. I think there were two things at play. Now, I was watching late morning, for people on the East Coast, it would have been midday, but I was watching Neil Cavuto. He comes on after Stuart Varney on Fox Business News. And the theory, he had Charlie Gasparino, who I'm kind of a fan of Charlie Gasparino, although every once in a while I so adamantly disagree with his opinion on things. I actually really like him because I think he's incredibly smart. This is no kind of a kiss up. He doesn't know me from Adam, but I think the guy is very, very smart. I think he has cultivated some amazing resources over his career. He seems to be connected to some people that really do know what's going on. Once in a while, it's not very often, but once in a while, I find myself disagreeing with him on his opinion. But he was one of the first people on with Neil Cavuto this morning, and talking a little bit about why, you know, this was 2.5 hours into the trading session, and they were talking about why the markets were moving to the upside. Most of it was on what Jerome Powell said, but the interesting thing is that everybody heard, when I say everybody, those people that were buying more today and pushing the markets in an upward direction, they seemed to hear what they wanted to hear from Jerome Powell, because what Jerome Powell shared today did not really bode well in the way of interest rate cuts. And it's almost as though the market sort of read into this news that we're for sure going to have interest rate cuts. What I loved about Charlie Gasparino's little segment on Neil Cavuto today is he pointed out something that I have referred to very often. And he said, one of the great things about Jerome Powell is whatever he telegraphs, he stays with. How many times have I made the analogy to you in these podcasts that Jerome Powell reminds me of the linebacker that steps up to the line? I know it's a football analogy and not all of you are football fans, but linebacker steps up to the line. And while he's face to face with the quarterback and looking right at him, he says to the quarterback, "Hey, we're gonna blitz." And the quarterback looks at him funny, like, "Why are you giving me this information?" And then, sure enough, the defense blitzes. And the people that sometimes think they're trying to outthink Jerome Powell or trying to read into what he says or not picking up on what he is obviously telegraphing, they're like the idiot quarterback that never believes that linebacker on the other side of the line that keeps saying we're going to blitz, even though he follows through with it and blitzes every single solitary time. So, Gasparino pointed out that Jerome Powell has indicated that March is likely off the table, May is likely off the table for a rate cut. There may be a 25 basis point cut in June. And then maybe another cut in September, and maybe another cut after the elections, which would probably push it into December. But Jerome Powell has also hinted towards or telegraphed that it's data dependent and that they will change their posture or change their plan if inflation rears its head a little bit again. I personally think that inflation is going to flare back up a little bit during the summer. I think you're going to have higher oil prices. That leads to higher gasoline prices. Gasoline and diesel drive this economy in so many ways, and it makes the cost of goods go a little bit higher. And even though we had a slightly weaker than expected job report this morning, I'll talk about that in a minute, even though we got a slightly weaker than expected job report, which is good for the possibility of a rate cut, I don't think it was a weak enough job report to get a lot of hope up for another rate cut or a sooner rate cut or more rate cuts. It's here you got Jerome Powell totally telegraphing what he's planning on doing. And yet the market's kind of read it as though it's a foregone conclusion that there will still be three rate cuts this year. I personally don't believe there will be three rate cuts this year. In fact, I believe there will be at best one rate cut this year. And I won't be surprised if we get to the end of this calendar year and there have not been any rate cuts. I will not be shocked by that at all if that ends up being the case. So, as it relates to rate cuts, this is kind of part two of what drove the markets up. So, part one was that Powell, and look at this headline. Powell, I don't know if you can see this. If you're watching the video instead of just listening to the podcast, I'm looking at the economic calendar for this week, and on Wednesday it says, and under Powell's comments, they threw the headline in here. Powell says rate cuts rates. Let me read this correctly. Sorry. Powell says rates likely at peak, cuts likely later in 2024. But that's not everything Jerome Powell said. Jerome Powell reiterated that the Fed is data dependent and that things could change. And that part of it is left out of even this headline. So it's, but the market read into that, oh, we're just going to put push back from May to June on a likely rate cut. And then, they're still making this assumption that there are more rate cuts coming before the end of the year. And like I said, I'm just personally not buying it. I don't think we're going to have more rate cuts. And I won't be surprised if we only get one or get none. Now, as it relates to the jobs report, the ADP, which is the private payroll report, the estimate was for 150,000 new jobs. The actual was 140. So it was lower. And remember, if you listened to the podcast yesterday, I told you that lower would be better as far as rate cuts are concerned, that a suppressed job market was a good thing for the possibility of rate cuts. But this was not a lot lower, and it was offset a little bit by last month's number being revised to the upside a little bit. So last month's number was 107. It got revised up to 111, which is a good portion of what today's miss was by. So I feel like those two things kind of balanced each other out. I realize those numbers don't balance each other out perfectly, but I feel like they had kind of a balancing effect on each other to where even though this miss was a good thing for the markets and a good thing for the markets because it suggests a possibility of a rate cut coming sooner, I think it had more to do with people reading into the market. And I said there were two things. There's one other thing. Those two things were kind of tied together. The one other thing that I think people were discounting a little bit too much is that after the huge night that Donald Trump had last night, it essentially knocked Nikki Haley out of the race for the Republican primary. And even though she didn't do it last night, this morning she conceded and pulled out, which I think was the right thing to do. And I gotta tell you, I have no dislike for Nikki Haley. I think Nikki Haley has been very unfairly beat up on. And I hope that in the very near future that her and Trump can find a way to reconcile that brings with it the possibility of some Nikki Haley voters coming onto Trump's side. Unfortunately, a large percentage of Nikki Haley voters are saying that they will never support Donald Trump under any circumstances. And I think if they really think of themselves as conservatives and as Republicans, that makes them absolute idiotic fools, in my opinion, because they don't understand the pragmatism that is needed in politics. You might hate Donald Trump, but if you don't want 4 more years of Joe Biden's country destroying, democracy destroying, ridiculous policies, then you cannot sit on your hands and not vote for his opponent, whether you like that opponent or not. That's the pragmatism of politics that some people, especially more so on the Republican Party, on the Republican side than on the Democrat side, simply do not get. And like I said, politically, in my opinion, it makes them fools. To get on your moral high horse and sit there and say, well, if I don't get my way, I'm going to take my ball and go home. That makes you a damned idiot. If you love your country and you love democracy and you believe in conservative principles, vote for the conservative candidate, even if you don't like them, because the alternative is another 4 years of the other candidate who will destroy this country if he's given 4 more years. He's done a lot to destroy it in the previous 3.5 years. He will completely destroy it if given 4 more years to do so. And so I think Nikki Haley dropping out and the markets recognizing the greater certainty of this being down to two candidates now. Markets like certainty. Markets, the US stock market reacts unfavorably to uncertainty. And so you got a step closer to some certainty in terms of what's going to happen in the elections. And I think that had a bigger deal to today's move up than some people would credit it. In fact, I heard some people early this morning on some of the news programs saying that that likely had little or nothing to do with the rebound today after yesterday's sell-off, but I'm of a different opinion. I think it had more to do with it than people are giving it credit. Now, as far as the rest of the week goes, tomorrow, productivity and costs, jobless claims, international trade, Jerome Powell will continue to make comments and speak. There's more that could be read into that. But I think the rest of the employment picture that comes on Friday morning is going to be a bigger market mover. Unless jobless claims were way higher than anticipated, way higher than expected, or yeah, I mean, it'd have to be that kind of a surprise or so much, better, such a better number than expected, meaning a lot lower than what the anticipated number is. Unless it's a huge miss in one direction or the other, I don't think the jobless claims number is going to have a big effect on tomorrow's market. I think Jerome Powell could be asked some questions or make some comments that could have an effect, but I think tomorrow is going to be maybe similar today. Another little bit of a rebound, if nothing else, on a little bit of a buy the dip thought process and a FOMO process. And then I think Friday, when we get that bigger, broader jobs picture, that's when I think you're going to see a big move up or a big move down to this week's market. And I think Friday will be the determining day. for whether we end on a positive or a negative note for this week. So we'll see what happens. We'll see if tomorrow we get more or less of a rally than what I'm thinking. And then Friday, my expectation is Friday we're going to sell off a little bit. This is going to be only maybe the third or fourth week of this calendar year that the markets might show a slight downward trend by the end of the trading session on Friday. I don't think it'll be big, but I think it will be slightly down by the time Friday gets here. All right, I'm going to wrap up right there. I hope you had a great Wednesday. I hope you have a great Thursday, and we'll do this again tomorrow after the market closes. Thanks, everyone. Bye-bye.